Okay, today we're going to be talking about stride piano. Stride is a style that I absolutely love. It has its roots in early jazz piano and ragtime and blues and the popular music of the 1920s and the 1930s. You still hear it played loads today because it's such a flexible, kind of multifaceted style. You can use it for so much stuff. I have talked a little bit about stride in the past, but for those of you who aren't familiar with what it is, let me just recap exactly how we define the style. Okay, so stride piano gets its name from the left hand, yeah? This is a stride left hand. And as you can see, what I'm doing is striding from one octave to another. Typically, I'm playing a single low note down here in this octave, a couple of octaves below middle C, alternating with a block chord in the octave immediately below middle C, sometimes straying a bit higher. Yeah, so that individual note down there will sometimes go a bit lower and the chord will sometimes come a bit higher, depending on how adventurous you are or what key you're playing in or whatever. But that's basically how it works. It's a straight four in the bar usually. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Yeah, and that might seem pretty simple, but as I say, it allows you an incredible amount of flexibility. Yeah, so if you're into cocktail piano, for example, stride gives you a really sort of mellow, yet rhythmic kind of approach, but it can also be quite hard driving. Okay, so you know, you can use a variety of tempos with a variety of styles. All of them tend to be kind of vaguely jazzy or bluesy styles, okay, but within that kind of huge genre, stride gives you an enormous amount of kind of opportunity. Okay, so in this tutorial, what I'm going to do is kind of the usual drill in that I have, when I do this sort of thing, I have a chord progression that I'm going to take you through and then show you how you can improvise on it in the stride style and kind of take it away and make it your own and play around with it. As usual, I'm going to assume that you know some basic stuff about chords, and you know, if I talk about particular chords or if I talk about terms like extension or substitution, you have at least a vague sense of what I'm talking about. Yeah, I'll try to fill in bits as I go, but you know, if you don't know anything about chords, now is the time to dig back in my timeline and look at some of my earlier material where all of this is explained. My recent video on, you know, all the piano chords you'll ever need in one epic tutorial, not far back, you'll find that useful. Also, if you're really new to chords and harmony, my book, How to Really Play the Piano, has got all this stuff in it. Yeah, a whole section on chords, Understanding Harmony, Part 1. Okay, so for now, as usual, I'm just going to assume that you know what I'm talking about. So let's have a look at this chord progression. What I'll do is play it through and improvise on it a little bit and then talk about the individual chords. Like a lot of the progressions I use, it finishes there on G7, because we're in the key of C major, G7, which is the number 5 chord in the key of C major, so that resolves naturally back onto the number 1 chord, C, okay, to take us back into the loop again, so we can keep playing it over and over and over and over again. Okay, so let's go through what those basic chords are. I'll talk about the basic underlying chords because often I'm extending them or substituting them or changing them in some way, but let's get our head around the basic progression first. Okay, so we've got C followed by E flat diminished 7, okay, E flat diminished 7, then D minor 7, then G7. And then that little pattern repeats: C, E flat diminished 7, D minor 7, G7. And then we come to this little kind of classic jazz turnaround section of C, C7, often plays over an E, F, F minor, often plays over an A flat, and then back to C, and then to a non-diatonic chord, a chord that is natural to the key of C, which is A flat 7, then to D minor 7, and then to G7, yeah? Excuse me. Let me play through the sequence again, and I'll do it really slowly and shout out the chords just so that you can kind of get it into your head what I'm doing. I'll embellish a little bit, so you'll see, for example, that often when I'm playing a C, the chord that comes out is actually C6. I'm adding an A in there. Okay, that's a 6 chord, so very frequently the underlying C chord becomes a C6. But it could be equally C major 7 or C9 or something, or C major 9, something like that. Anyway, let me play through and shout out the basic underlying chords. Not necessarily the exact chords I'm playing, but the basic underlying chords. Here we go. C, E flat diminished 7, D minor 7, G7. C, E flat diminished 7, D minor 7, G7. C, C7, F. F minor, C, A flat 7, D minor 7, G7, okay, and that takes us back to the start, okay. Notice there that I was striding for some of it, but you can break up the stride, yeah, especially if you're getting towards a turnaround, and play single notes in the left as well, but, you know, that's just an example of the way you can vary the style. Let's look at how we can take that progression and turn it into a really cool stride style improvisation. The first thing we need to get right is the left hand, yeah? And if you're new to stride, it's worth practicing this left hand by itself first until you're really confident with it, yeah? What you're after is precision. So we're jumping precisely from one chord to the other and confidently without too many bum notes or without any bum notes at all, if you can help it, especially with the single notes by themselves down here, because that will be really noticeable. So we're after precision, okay? And we're also after a good, steady rhythm, yeah? Ideally, it needs to be like clockwork. Sometimes in stride, you know, if you're using it in cocktail, for example, then you can let the rhythm slip and slide a little bit, use a little bit of rubato. But here, for this kind of, I guess, kind of trad jazz kind of style, then what we need is clockwork in the left hand, yeah? So just take that left hand and practice making it precise and regular, and that might take a little while, yeah? That little turnaround section there where we get to C, C7, F, F minor, we've got a lot of black notes coming in. Black notes are dead easy to slip off if you come at them quickly. So don't be afraid to really bury your hand deep in the keyboard where it's more secure. Look at what I do here, yeah? Gone up quite a long way there to get a good secure thumb on B flat and then F, F minor, and look at my third finger there, really deep into the A flat key, yeah? So shove them up right deep into the keyboard there, yeah? Just for security. You might also want to use a little bit of pedal. You know, you don't have to. You can make things quite bouncy without pedal. But for what we're doing here, a bit of pedal would be cool. And listen to how I'm pedaling. I'm going pedal, 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 pedal. Basically, just sticking each chord group together, you know, between the chord starting and the chord changing. Just experiment and play around with the pedal and see how you are. But as I say, get that left hand down first, because, you know, before you even begin to think about what's going on in the right, that has to be, you know, you have to be really comfortable with it. As you get more used to the style, you'll find that you can just read chords and put a stride together kind of on the hoof, as it were. But if you're new to the style, you know, you need to nail that down now. When it comes to right hand improvisation, one of the great things about this style is that you can achieve an awful lot just using chord shapes, okay? To show you what I mean, what I'm going to do is just play through a couple of times and then explain some of the techniques that I'm using. I'll take it fairly steadily, and first time through, in particular, I'll make sure that I keep the right hand fairly simple. Okay, here we go. Thank you. Okay, so that's our two times through. Let's look at some of the stuff that I was doing there. Okay, as I said, most of what I was doing there was just based around chord shapes. In particular, what I was doing was playing the chords in rhythmic ways to create interest. A lot of people forget this about improvisation, but when you're improvising, you don't necessarily have to play loads of different notes. Instead, you can create the interest by playing cool rhythms, as I was doing there. Okay, so those are very basic chord shapes I'm playing, very close to the original chords. But as I say, all I'm doing is thinking about what I can do rhythmically, or almost treating the piano like a kind of drum kit, kind of, you know, playing it as a percussion instrument. Yeah, to help me do that, as you saw just then, sometimes I'm breaking the chord up. Yeah. Mostly, it's just the simple chord shapes. I created one little bit of variation that first time through. When I played the E flat diminished 7 chord, I think in the the 6th bar, I did this. Okay, just creating a tiny bit of melodic interest by going up to that D above. And it's not very much, it's just one extra note, but it just creates a bit of variety, a bit of extra interest. So I'm being very kind of conservative in the notes I'm actually playing, but as I say, creating the interest, creating the musicality using the rhythm. When things began to get a bit more adventurous the second time through, really I wasn't doing a lot more than just playing chord shapes, but I was jumping around quite a bit, okay? So you were getting things like this. Yeah, that's quite a nice little effect. I was jumping from C6 to C6 and then hitting the E flat diminished 7 and giving it a bit of a tremolo, which is always a nice effect, tremolo in this style. And then going to the, what did I do next? Yeah, it was a D minor 7, it was a D minor 7 chord with a bit of suspended G, again, a tiny bit of extra interest. Okay. Not straying very far from the chord shape at all, yeah? There was a certain amount of extension going on, so at various times I was doing things like, instead of playing C7, I was playing C9. You know, there's all sorts of things you can do there, especially in that turnaround section. You can go up to something like F major 9 there, F minor 9, or all sorts of cool stuff, but fundamentally I'm staying close to the chords. Now the way to get into that is to know the chords really well and just play the shapes over and over again. So once you've got your left hand sorted out, if at first all you're comfortable with is this, then just do that. But after a while you should find that you want to kind of branch out a little bit. Once you get really confident, you can do some of the more spectacular stuff. I mean, it's not very difficult, actually. I did a bit of a run. Yeah. All that is... hold on. The trouble with this stuff is it's really instinctive, and breaking down exactly what you do is sometimes quite difficult. Whoops. So... yeah, hitting the chords and then up the arpeggio to the C7 and a bit of a tremolo. But there, after that, on the F and the F minor 7 I played, we're just back to playing chords in rhythmic ways. Just a quick tip, something you'll find when you're playing stride, but because your left hand is taking up a lot of space, if you're not careful, left and right can start fighting in the middle of the keyboard, okay? So right hand improvisation starts to take you lower and lower and lower, left hands come up and crash, suddenly they're fighting each other. A good thing, therefore, when you're improvising is to try to keep your two hands relatively consciously far apart, yeah? And generally, if you're doing a lot of your improvisation in this octave or around here, you're safer than it if you're using the areas around here. Okay, so that's it. What you should do now is take that progression, as I say, practice that left hand stride really religiously first, and begin to play around with it. It will take you a little while if you're new to it, but you know, give it a go. As I said at the start, if you're new to this stuff, subscribe to my channel, please do. Check out some of my earlier videos on chords and harmony. Have a look at my book, How to Really Play the Piano, The Stuff Your Teacher Never Taught You. It does explain all the basics of chords. There's even there's a 4-section 12-bar blues to get you started on improvisation. And there is even a section in here on stride, some work which I can't find immediately, but there's definitely, there it is. Yeah, there's a stride pattern there. Okay, and so loads of stuff in there, print edition, digital edition, both available. Just click the link at the top of the video or in the top right hand corner and you can find out more about that. There's my cocktail piano ebook as well, which you can also find out about on my website. Right now I'm absolutely flogging myself trying to finish my new book, Seven Studies in Pop Piano, which I'm hoping is going to be out about a month's time from now. Okay. So that's kind of it. I'm going to kind of go and have a bit of a chill out now, because that was quite a difficult one. So I will see you again in a few weeks' time. Any questions, by the way, just stick them on the video as usual. See you soon.